fornication, masturbation, pornography, all that stuff, right? You can't just apply a moral prohibition over it and expect it to stop. It's not going to. The male creative energy impetus gets channeled into the sexual drive. And so what happens is the desire gets distorted. And a lot of it is because of the ubiquity of pornography.
Oh, no question.
They need to learn how to become men because no one's ever taught them. The father's love is like water to the soul of the boy. He needs the paternal love. You know what you do when you do that is you free your husband to be a man. He doesn't need to be belittled. He doesn't need to be criticized. What they'll do is they'll check out because they're not wired that way. Wired that way. They can't take it. The primary struggle for the female is contentment. And if she's feeling discontent, lots of times she does not realize that that's part of her spiritual struggle. So with feminism, it kind of provides a false logic where the discontent can be turned into resentment. If he feels that his wife is antagonistic towards him, it's going to compel him to roam. Have you ever looked at the Antifa guys? They're all man boys.
What do you
They're
mean? You say
man boys.
Thank you for joining us for this episode of the Dr. J Show. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse for the Ruth Institute, and my guest today is Father Johannes Jacobse, also known as Father Hans, who is an Orthodox priest who has a very interesting perspective on the problems that men face in modern society. You're going to be very interested in this interview. I've never heard anything quite like what we're going to talk about today, so be sure that you click the subscribe button so that you never miss an important interview like this one. Father Hans, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Well, it's great to be here.
Well, it's nice to get reacquainted. We've met a few times at the Acton Institute, but
yes.
This is a part of your work that I just didn't know was out there. And Father Mark called my attention to it. And I started reading it and I thought, wow, this is a very interesting perspective that you have on masculinity and pornography and masculinity in generally and the problems of pornography. So let's just dive right into it. Before we start, though, I think you may be the first, I think you're the first Orthodox priest we've had as a guest on the show. And so if you wouldn't mind, just can you briefly outline the Orthodox position on marriage, family, and human sexuality and how it fits in with the broader Judeo-Christian tradition?
Well, It goes back, you know, to the fathers, the teaching. Marriage is between one man, one woman. Sexuality is to be within marriage. It has a particular telos, the creation of new children. It doesn't belong outside of marriage. And sexuality, marriage, family, and sexuality. Family is the primary unit. You look at Genesis, God created Adam. He created Eve. It's not just in a sociological sense, but ontological. The family is absolutely critical for civilization, for flourishing, for peace. Just what more can I say?
You're right. Well, in other words, we're all on the same bus here.
Yeah, we're on the same bus. No question.
The same Judeo-Christian bus. We've all got roughly the same position. So
right.
I just wanted to, you know, to be sure we started with that. Because as you know, that's what the Ruth Institute has been talking about for a long time. And I have no problem saying this is the tradition that, you know, the broadly conceived Judeo-Christian. The Judeo-Christian tradition, even though some branches of Christianity seem to be falling off the bus, you might say, on certain issues, this is the tradition and this is what we uphold. So good to have you on board.
We're on board.
I think you've been on this bus a long time, you guys. Yeah. So just briefly, what are some of the challenges that the Orthodox Church faces with respect to these issues, both from inside the church and outside the church?
Well, the same challenges that all of Western Christendom faces, which is the challenge of secularism, which is really disintegration of, it's a disintegration of ontology. It's an attempt to overtake nature. And, you know, it has political manifestations. The worst manifestations, of course, are the breakdown of the family. Mm-hmm. We're kind of fortunate in that respect. I mean, our divorce rates are still relatively low, but that's because, you know, the Eastern Church was never affected by the Enlightenment, okay? But the Eastern Church is in the West now. A lot more people becoming Orthodox. The reach of the EU is reaching countries like Greece. And so, you know, we're seeing that the problems that the Western Christians have creeping into Orthodoxy. At the same time, what we're seeing on the ground is we're seeing a lot of young men coming into the Orthodox Church, especially in the last few years. We're talking about thousands of young men coming into the Orthodox Church, coming, and you know, they're the children of the children of the boomers. Mm-hmm. And so it's I deal with them a lot. It's really interesting to see what happens to a person when they don't have any religious foundation in their life at all. And so what's happening with them is because they're suffering from the breakdown.
Yes.
And then they're finding the church and they're finding Orthodoxy, which, you know, to a lot of outside people seems very, very rigid. It's not. It's not that at all. But it does hold. It has a tighter hold on the tradition, and it does teach it in their parishes for the most part. And when I say for the most part, the greatly most part, and so we see the regeneration that's possible as well. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to ask, is this where the St. Passios Brotherhood comes into that you founded? Yeah.
Yeah.
Tell us about the St. Passios. Am I saying it correctly?
Paisios. Yeah, Paisios.
Paisios. He's a, okay.
Yeah, he's a modern day saint. He died in, I think, 1960s or something. But we see him active a lot. We still see him active. The reason I started it, because I started early dealing with these men coming in, okay? And I realized that their needs weren't being met in the ways that they needed to be met. And another reason I started is because I know a lot of priests just don't know how to deal with these problems that I'm dealing with. And so I said, I'm going to start a brotherhood and just see what happens. And it's growing. And my hope is, and I'm learning a lot, a whole lot. And my hope is to be able to show other priests how to deal with these particular problems that these men have coming from the outflow of a very broken culture. A lot of these guys just don't have solid relationships with their fathers, which really affects them. I know you do a lot of work in this type of thing. And they need healing. They need healing. They need spiritual healing. And that's where the whole foray into patriarchy and manhood comes up. They don't know how to be men.
Right.
They don't. They really want to know how to be a man. But if you don't have a father to teach you, who's going to teach you? Well, the dominant culture is going to teach you. That's what's happening. Now, you know, we can think back when we came of age, 13, 14, 15 years old, right? You awaken to the world. That's part of becoming an adult. But you tend to think that what you're awakening to is the way it's always been. And you kind of jump into it whole hog because you have no idea of the dysfunction and the damage that it can cause. It's only after you experience that the self-reflection begins. What I tell these guys, and they agree with me 100%, most of the young people coming into our church are coming out of soul pain. Real deep soul pain. It's not just emotional pain, it's soul pain. But in a way, that pain is a mercy, because that pain compelled them to look upward and beyond the limits of their own experience, and they encounter God. But they need healing. They come into the church, they need healing. And again, they need to learn how to become men, because no one's ever taught them.
And so that's the purpose of the brotherhood.
That's the purpose of the brotherhood.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
And so many of the things, I listened to a lecture that you did for Touchstone about 5 years ago, and that was already very interesting, and you've developed even since then.
Yes.
I want to share one little experience I had that I think you'll relate to. I was one time doing a talk with a bunch of women, and Catholic women in Phoenix, and one of the ladies asked me, you know, Dr. Morse, what can we do as mothers to help our sons become good Christian men? And I these words just came out of my mouth. I did not plan this whatsoever. I shocked myself. I said, we can't do it. We can't do it. We have to get out of the way and let our husbands do it. And that was like a big shock to me. I didn't know I was going to say that, you know, but why was I right? I mean, what is it that a woman can't do? What's missing when a woman tries to mentor a man? Why doesn't that work, Father?
It doesn't work because it's only the father's love. The father's love is like water to the soul of the boy. He needs the paternal love. The mother's love is a love of safety. The father's love is the entrance into manhood. That's what it is. He needs the paternal love. It's the way his soul is structured.
Yes. I think that's right. I mean, I think that, well, that unpacking that, we could spend the whole next hour unpacking what that exactly means.
Let me say one thing to that, because this is something I've discovered. A lot of these men have huge feelings of inadequacy. Mm. Okay. And these feelings of inadequacy are very evident when they're around women. It's really inadequacy, feeling inadequate about their own manhood, not sexually, just their masculine self-identity. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so what they think is that, okay, if they pair up with a woman, that the inadequacy will be healed. That's not it at all. The only way that the inadequacy is healed is when they enter into a relationship with a spiritual father, with a mentor, or with a brother, right? Mm-hmm. In other words, when they enter into a relationship where the paternal love can be experienced, because the only thing that heals it's not really a problem of psychoanalysis, it's a problem of healing the soul. Because when that spirit, when that love is felt and that love is experienced, then the soul can heal. The healing of the soul is what takes care of the inadequacy. In addition, you know, to learning practical skills and this and that, but that's really what needs to happen. This is what I've discovered.
And when a father and son are doing things together, like washing the car or fixing something around the house or going fishing or doing those type of activities, part of what is happening is that it's not just the activities. It's also that masculine love and that sense of adequacy as a man that is being created or nurtured, I guess you could say.
Which is being given from the father to the son. It's being given from the father to the son. And love, the love that's expressed, and expressed in very practical ways. I mean, guys love to do stuff.
Exactly.
Sometimes you can get a guy sitting around a table, right, and talking. And that'll last for a while, but they like to do stuff. Okay, right. So you have a barbecue instead. It's just enough, right?
Kind
of thing. But it's in that. It's in the communion. It's in the relationship. It's the actualization of the way God created us to be relational. The Trinity is relational. Everything is relational. Life is given through relationship, including the healing of the soul. And the healing of the soul, many times, is also the healing of the psyche.
Right. And the overemphasis on the psyche has diverted our attention, away from the thing that really needs attention, right? And as we become secularized, we don't take the soul seriously. You know, we put it all in our psychology. What then spiritual becomes psychologized.
And, exactly. And then psychology becomes Gnostic.
What else could it be? You know, I mean,
Right.
You said so many different things. I want to go back to the I've lost my train of thought here because this is so rich. Well, you know what? Why don't you just tell us a little bit about what goes on in the Brotherhood? What do you guys do together? How do you get started, Father Hans?
Okay, here's the theory. Here's the theory, and this theory is not really a theory. It's articulation of reality. Okay. men learn how to become a man from other men. Okay, so you ideally want to create a father-son mentor-mentee relationship, but you also want to create brotherhood. Because if a brother helps a brother, he's actually fathering that brother, because it's paternal love, it's masculine love. Mm-hmm. One of the crises of our age are these guys are so lonely.
Yeah.
They're so lonely, right? And they want to connect, but they can't, you know, they can't. And it's some of the propaganda in our society really contributes that too, because affection between men is seen as gay.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
I'll just say it, but it's not. It's not
sexualized,
that,
you know,
the
alternative to spiritualization, if not psychologizing it, is then to sexualize it.
So it's a sexualizer.
Yeah. Yeah.
So yeah.
And friendship. Yeah. We had a young guy say this to us one time, Father, a guy who had lived a he shared with us a friend who had lived a whole lifetime as a gay man. And finally, in his 50s, figured out that all he was looking for was friendship.
Yeah.
What a sad loss, you know, of all that time that he was looking for the wrong thing.
Yeah, but that recognition is also the healing.
Indeed.
It's also the healing.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, and the sexual desire can actually be healed. Can be healed. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's unpopular to say. You're not supposed to say that, but it's true. I've seen it.
It happens every
I've seen
day.
It.
Men lead the gay lifestyle every day. It happens all the time.
Yes, it does. So it was to create, getting back to your question, it was to create a place, even if it was virtual, where this fellowship could form. And I tell you, the response to it was very, very good. I mean, there's certain rules. We don't get into politics. I mean, some of these guys have been red-pilled. Some of your audience will know what that means, right? We don't do red-pill stuff, and we certainly don't do black-pill, okay? And that I said, we're not doing that, guys. We're here for a different purpose. So there are some parameters, but otherwise, it's largely self-directed. I've got five or six guys who kind of became moderators, and we've got different topics, hobbies, this and that. Just started out as one chat room. We use Telegram. But now it's growing. The support, there's a force multiplier here because they're all there for the same purpose. They want to get better. They want to find their road to masculinity. They want human flourishing, and they really want deep friendship. They want communion with each other. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I foster that. I encourage that. My goal is to see these fellowships just grow. I'm not trying to build a top-down organization. I'm just trying to provide the resources that they can flourish on their own and provide some direction. But that's what's happening. That's really what's happening. And we're developing it now. I do a lot on pornography with young men. They call me up. I've got two texts I have to respond to. They came in today. You know, two guys really struggling with it. They saw some of the videos I did, and they contact me. Mm-hmm. And I realized, you know, I've got to find a new way to do this. So I've got a beta group going. I call it ASI, Achieving Sexual Integrity, where guys who are struggling together, and it's a beta group, so I can learn how to do this. But I'm really, really gratified by the response, because it's a lot more powerful in a group than just me one-on-one. Right. Mm-hmm. So I got 12 guys. So it's going really well. Learning the ropes a little bit. I'm going to do one more beta group. Hopefully some of these guys will graduate from it and become leaders themselves, right? That's the plan. But then after the second beta group, I'm going to write a manual. Mm-hmm. I'm going to write a book on just how to do this. And because there's guys who want to learn how to mentor and do this kind of thing for other men, and they just don't have the tools. So I'm going to write the book, and I'm going to give them the tools. My approach is a little bit different than other approaches, but I've found that it works.
Well, this is what fascinated me in your Touchstone lecture. And then in this chapter you sent me, you contributed a chapter to an essay in a book, and you very kindly sent it to me. And what you're really doing, it seems to me, is applying Christian anthropology and a Christian understanding of human sexuality and how it fits into our lives. And to me, your approach is much more powerful, if I could say that, potent, you know, is much more potent than what we're dealing with, because you draw a distinction between rightly channeled sexual energy and dissipated sexual energy. So talk to people a little bit about that, because when I read it, I went, yeah, this has got to be true. But I had never put it together that way. So walk us through that, will you, Father Hans, so people can see what you think.
Well, it's grounded in a teaching by Saint Maximus the Confessor, 8th century, but he probably is the master of human anthropology. And he said this, and it really caught my ear. He said, all desire, even inordinate desire, is grounded in the desire for God. And that really got me thinking. And I'm thinking, you know, this whole emphasis on you know, sexual desire, especially inordinate sexual desire, fornication, masturbation, pornography, all that stuff, right? You can't just treat it as... you can't just apply a moral prohibition over it and expect it to stop. It's not going to. Okay. It's grounded in something else. And so in dealing with these men, I prayed a lot about this, because guys would come to me, what's the answer? I prayed. And I really do believe I got some divine insight from the Lord on this, but the male creates with his hands. He builds stuff. All right. And we've all experienced, all men have experienced, you know, the gratification you feel with a job well done, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So what happens? So man has a need to create, And, but if that need to create gets channeled into the sexual drive, then the gratification that comes with authentic creativity, when you actually add value to human life, yours and other people's, that gets confused with the sexual gratification. Now, the sexual gratification itself is good, properly contextualized. Yeah, that's when the man and the woman become one.
Right.
Okay? That's when the man and the woman become one, intensely pleasurable, but designed so by God. All right? But that the male creative energy impetus gets channeled into the sexual drive. And so what happens is the desire gets distorted. The desire for that gratification that comes when you create is mixed up with the gratification that comes in the sexual act, properly contextualized. And so this begins very young. It begins 12, 13 years old, and a lot of it is because of the ubiquity of pornography.
Oh, no question. Yeah, we've done a number of interviews and shows about that problem. The average age that a child first encounters pornography has dropped. Now it's something like 8 years old when they first see it on their phone or something like that. So their whole identity, not to mention their sexuality, their whole identity is being shaped by a very distorted image of what human sexuality is all about.
Yeah, and it prohibits maturation, because what happens is it becomes a release for frustration. Well, life is pretty frustrating, especially when you're growing up, right? And so the masturbation becomes habituated. See, people call it pornography addiction, and I guess you could call it that, but I really see it as masturbation addiction. The real problem is an addiction to masturbation.
Right.
Okay. Pornography functions as a masturbation accelerant. You really got to deal with the masturbation.
Mm-hmm.
And how do you deal with the masturbation? Well, and of course, you know, what happens is they grow up, and 18, 19, they start realizing this is a big problem, and it's held them back, but they don't put it together that simply yet. They just know that they're struggling, and they carry that into young adulthood, sometimes even later, sometimes even into their 40s. Okay. But what I do is, here's the therapy. The therapy is, okay, we're going to practice abstinence, which means you're going to really try not to do it. You're going to be real serious about it, and you're going to resist it. Now, what happens is, there's a difference between the temptation and the act. The act is the sin. Okay. The act is the sin. The temptation's not the sin. The temptation is something we experience because we live in a fallen. Okay.
Right.
And so you create a space between the temptation and the act. Okay. And in that space, you look into that space and you see what comes up. And that's where you begin the healing, which is to say the redirecting of the misdirected desire.
Right, 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 right. You're going to do something with that desire before it becomes the act. Right?
Yeah, and that's where the mentoring is really important, because you can see the talent in the boy, in the young man. You can see it. He has no idea because he has no accomplishment, real accomplishment. Right. He has on occasion experienced the gratification that comes from creative work, but he can't put it together yet. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes I just say, you have to do this, you have to do that. I just direct him. You have to do the third thing.
Mm-hmm.
You got to get a job. I told one guy, I said, you got to get a job. I said, I want you to do landscaping for a year. You've got to learn. Your body has mastered you your whole life. You have to learn how to master your body. Okay. And I said, you just got to work. I said, if you're serious about this, I asked him, are you serious about this? They go, yeah. I said, then you're going to have to follow what I tell you. I will. Mm-hmm. And they do.
Mm-hmm.
You got to do landscaping.
Hold it right there. Hold it right there. You right. tell them with confidence, this is what you need to do.
Okay. Yes.
And part of what happens in the modern world, where we have made such an idol out of self-actualization and self-choice and autonomy and all of that, we don't realize that one of the things we're missing is the opportunity to follow somebody who loves us and who has our interests at heart and who has the confidence to say, you need to do this. And we're not even discussing this anymore. Just do it,
Yeah.
So I just want to emphasize that to parents everywhere, to people in authority everywhere. You don't have to be, you know, it's not being authoritarian or bossy or mean or inappropriate to say with confidence, this is what you need to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And he decides whether he's going to do it or not. But you see, it's up to him. I said, you know, if you're not going to do it, then we're not going to get anywhere. That's all I tell them. We're not debating this. We're not debating.
Right.
No. You're either doing it or you're not.
You know, there was a study years ago that I read when I was trying to figure out how to be a mom because we had some disturbed kids that we had to deal with. There's literally studies that show that mothers natter their children.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they just go back and forth and talk. And it's not effective. Ladies,
no,
shut up. Stop.
Yeah.
Just say it once and then be quiet.
Yeah.
Sorry. I just nattered you. I'm sorry, Father.
Well, he did it. Okay.
Yeah.
It's 6 months later, he came and I said, you have to go every day. You have to get there on time. And the only time you don't go is if you're really sick, you're not allowed. I said this, you're not allowed to call in and say you're sick because you don't want to go to work. The only time you don't go is when you are really sick or you got a doctor's or dentist appointment. I said, that's the only time. And he did it. And 6 months, he came to me, he says, I want to go to college. His first time was a crash and burn. And I could see he really did. And I said, okay, let's go to college. And he moved out of the city, moved somewhere else. And he needed to get away from his friends and environment.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't have any money. And the first time was a crash and burn, so he was in a state school, right? And I said, okay, I really did this. I said, okay, I didn't know how I was going to do it. And I didn't know how I was going to do it. I said, don't worry about it. I'm going to raise the money for your first semester. And I did. I just asked a few people, and they gave me money. Right? I just knew this is what he had to do, you know?
I love that. I love that trusting on your part. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I promised this kid I'm going to do it, so somehow I'm going to do it.
Yeah, I say that a lot. I don't quite know how I'm going to do it, but it works, you know?
Right.
And I did it the second semester, but by the time he had two semesters, his grades were so good, he started getting financial aid. Ended up in a great school. Okay, did 2 years there, ended up in a great school. He's flourishing. He's flourishing. And This, there's a lot of success stories like that.
No,
this it's not that hard.
Yeah. Do you know, one of the things that jumped out at me as I read your material and as I heard you talking on Touchstone, is that, you know, Freud used to have a theory that sexual dissipation undermined civilization, right? And that, that to build civilization, you had to channel the sexual urge. And at the same time, he thought it was, it made people neurotic. So on net, his contribution was probably negative. But the point is, you're saying in a way something that is similar in the sense that the way you channel that sexual energy can have massive spillover effects. It's not just about whether you're having sex or how you're having sex. There's something much deeper at stake in the channeling of sexual drive.
Yeah. If a man doesn't channel a sexual drive, he's not going to flourish. He's just not. And he's going to be afflicted with deep insecurities. It's just really true. Now, that's a general statement. Everybody is different. I get that. But a general statement, it's true. It really is true.
Yeah. And in what way are men and women different in this area? You know, I want you to spell out, you know, you're concerned with men and you're dealing with men. Some of the problems we have now in modern times have to do with what I would consider a misguided feminism, a feminism that takes as its premise that men and women are naturally at odds with each other, and that this group of women, ideological women, speak for everybody, which obviously they don't speak for me and for a lot of other women. But the influence of feminism is undeniable, and it has taught men that to be masculine is to be toxic somehow. Masculine virtues are a problem, somehow a social problem. And somehow that's supposed to elevate women. You know, I mean, we're supposed to feel uplifted by that because they're worse and we're better or something, you know. So I think it would be helpful if you could kind of talk through the different ways that you see men and women flourishing legitimately, nothing toxic about it, but a legitimate flourishing for the man versus the legitimate flourishing for the woman.
Well, that's a big question. It's a big question. I get asked all the time, well, why aren't you doing this for women? And my answer is because just like a man, men need men to learn how to become a man, women need women to learn how to become a woman. And I'm waiting for women to rise up. Okay. And I'm seeing a little bit here and there, but women have to hear from other women how to be a woman. And right now, the dominant culture, and especially that kind of that feminist undercurrent that is everywhere, I really think hurts women.
Oh, no question about that. Yeah.
Hurts them. I have a friend, a counselor, female, and she deals with a lot of the outflow of the sexual revolution among young women. Boy, talk about, I hear these stories. Yeah. Devastating. Mm-hmm. You know, men, the whole sexual, the misguided dynamic within in sexual licentiousness. Okay. Part of it is a soul search. It is, especially among the young, right? It's not just raw lust like people. It's a search. There's a search for a real relationship there, but it doesn't work. It's tremendously damaging. But the men are trying to learn to be men. And I think that the women are looking to be loved.
Yes.
That's what's happening. And the women are being taught now, well, you know, you sleep around until a guy connects with you, but a guy's never going to connect with somebody that way, right? And so we have damage on both sides. Mm-hmm. We have real damage on both sides. And, you know, I don't have specific answers to your question because my sole focus is mostly on men. This is my hope. I'll tell you what my hope is.
Okay.
My hope is that if the men can become stronger, the women can find themselves. That's what my hope is. I'm thinking that, you know, these men coming into the church, and if they grow up to be solid men, and I think there's a good chance many of them will, right? Then I think I think that there's a natural attractiveness between male and female, right? And I think that the attractiveness to men, they're taught it's all physical, but it's not really that. I mean, the attraction is physical, but the attraction is really to real femininity. They love that. Mm-hmm. A woman who is confident in her own femininity is very attractive to the stable man. So I'm hoping that as the men become more stable, the women will rediscover that and become more secure in their own femininity. That's what I'm hoping for. But I don't know how to teach a woman how to be more feminine. Right. I think it takes a woman to do that.
Right. And it would be asking too much to ask you to do that. But you pointed to some important points here. The first thing that I think we should say is that, in my opinion, from my observation, men are hardwired to want to please women. Mm-hmm. And I think that's true. Men want to please women. Well, this is a fact that feminism has completely hidden. Feminism has done everything possible to keep that concealed, both from men and from women.
Yeah.
Because, the need to please a woman motivates men to do all sorts of things.
Yeah.
That they wouldn't otherwise do. And so if you suppress that, the whole process of healthy attraction and healthy bonding is going to be disrupted. You know, that's going to mm-hmm. be. And the other thing about what you said about, if men can be really men, what I think women long to do is to be able to entrust themselves to their husbands. You know, mm-hmm. we want to be able to relax into the care of a powerful figure who loves us. You know, and power is not directed against us, but whose mm-hmm. power is used on our behalf.
Yes.
To protect us and our children from, whatever mm-hmm. else might be out there. That's what I, as a woman, that's how I would express it, And it took me, it took me so long to realize that relaxing into the care of my husband is what I really wanted to do. I didn't really want to win. I don't want to win, that's.
And you know what you do when you do that is you free your husband to be a man. He doesn't need to be belittled. He doesn't need to be criticized.
Right.
I'm sure I tell you, you do that to a guy, you start objecting to a guy, you see it as kind of a contractual equality here. Guys, what they'll do is they'll check out because they're mm-hmm. not wired that way.
Mm-hmm.
Not wired that way. They can't take it. There, I've seen some situations where otherwise, really, fine girls, but they're woke. They're woke.
Yeah.
And you know what? And they're chasing the good guys away.
Right. That's right. Do you know, I can remember some years ago, I forget, I was in confession complaining about something about my husband and disguising it as a sin of mine. And the priest said, Almighty God has put this man at the center of your life.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. At some point, I made a decision. I said, this man, he cannot listen to one bit of criticism. And I realized, well, then why don't you stop criticizing him?
Stop criticizing.
It's not getting you anything you want. Why don't you just stop? And I remember when I started doing that, he was so shocked. It's like I started thanking him for stuff. And he's like, she must want something,
Yeah.
It took a while to really squeeze that competitive. Feminism teaches us that to be a woman is to stand up for yourself, by golly, and it gave us all sorts of excuses to nag our husbands, which I personally mm-hmm. needed no coaching in that area, right? I mean, most women can figure out to nag without being prompted, right? And so when I let go of that, it took a while, but it was a radical transformation. And I made up my mind, no matter what he did, I was going to do what I thought was the right thing. I was going to mm-hmm. stop criticizing him. And mm-hmm. over time, he rose to the occasion. And that I think that's what you're saying. Yeah.
He got better, didn't he? He got better.
He got better. That's right.
He became a better husband. Yeah.
That's right. Oh, absolutely. He's a great husband. And he always was a good husband, but I had no idea I could love him so much as I do today compared to, when we first got married or even 10 years ago, but that's what's possible. If you, go ahead, Paul.
Your husband, if you love your husband, we like it. We like that a lot.
Yeah.
Okay. I think that the primary struggle for a male is fidelity, faithfulness.
Really?
And I think that, yeah, and I think that the primary struggle for the female is contentment. All right?
Say more about that. What do you mean about that?
Well, I think that the real harm of feminism is that it fosters resentment. A woman really needs to feel secure and content. Okay. And if she's feeling discontent, lots of times she does not realize that that's part of her spiritual struggle. The initial thing will be to place the blame for the contentment on the object of what's causing the discontent. That's initially what it is. It's the same with a man. If a man is struggling, he'll start roaming, okay, and set his eyes on something that promises to bring him some kind of relief from his anguish, okay, what he's feeling is discontent. And that won't, of course. He's got to deal with the issue inside, okay? So I think what happens with feminism is that it kind of provides a false logic where the discontent can be turned into resentment.
Mm-hmm.
And so, since you're going to have your greatest difficulty with your spouse, okay, because it's the small church, right? It's what the Apostle Paul says, the man has to give himself to the wife, and like Christ gave himself for the church and died for it, the man has to lose his life for his wife. And you know what? Men can do that. Okay, and the woman submits to the man, which means that she deals with her own discontent and her complaints and this and that as a primary personal spiritual problem, like you did. You confessed it, right? Then I think that the possibilities for a real flourishing relationship develops. Feminism undermines that because it takes the weakness of the female, right, and justifies something that creates the resentment, which is really a battery acid in a marriage, because if a man feels that he's not loved, if he feels that his wife is antagonistic towards him, it's going to compel him to roam. Is what it does, because he needs that relief. He needs to know that someone is taking care of him while he goes out and does what he needs to do.
Mm-hmm.
They really need that. Men need that.
Yeah, that's really interesting. That last bit that you said is really interesting, because it's easy to see men sacrificing themselves for the sake of their families when they go do jobs they don't really want to do, or you know, wait out on the subway platform day after day, and they endure things for the people that they love. But if they don't get love back, then all of that becomes dissipated in some way. And what you just said, and I have always thought of it that he's out there protecting us, but in a sense we are also protecting him. Right. Because he has something. He's doing it for a reason. He has a reason. He has a purpose. He has meaning to struggles in the outside world. And because he can look over his shoulder and know, you know, my wife is taking care of my home. I'm going to go there. I'm going to collapse at the end of the day and play with the kids, and it's going to be fine. You know, and it's all worth it. Now it becomes worth it instead of a meaningful struggle.
Yeah. And we're wired to be able to do that. We can do things we don't like to do.
Yeah.
We can do that if we have a purpose. If we don't have a purpose, then what's the point? Then it's meaningless.
Yeah.
Okay, but we can do work that is itself intrinsically meaningless if we have a purpose. If there's meaning in, not in the work necessarily, but in the doing of it, which is always other people.
Right.
Always other people.
Right. And men will go to the sound of the gunfire. Men will go towards it. Men will go towards the sound of the conflict. You know, and they should, we need them to, you know, society needs to channel that energy of men towards stuff. And what the modern world has done, feminism, but not largely feminism, but not exclusively feminism, has been to tell men that it doesn't matter, that what they do doesn't matter, or that that's toxic, that that's somehow toxic and inappropriate.
Young men are really affected by that because they want to be pleasing to women. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, if the women, I'm talking about younger, they just kind of pull this poison in from the culture, right? And so what they do is they set themselves up against the man.
Right.
And you know, it's called egalitarianism, but egalitarianism doesn't really exist, right? And so the men, in a sense, become more feminized, right? And that fosters a certain self-contempt. It does. They don't, and it robs them of the self-confidence that they need. And it affects them. It really affects them. It's something that has to be kind of, in a sense, almost deprogrammed from them. A lot of them end up hating the feminists, mm-hmm. because there is a rational reason, but they're just responding out of their gut,
right.
because of the intrinsic humiliation, that demasculinization that they feel. And I'll tell you, men cannot deal with that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the men that do internalize that, I don't know if you've noticed, but have you ever looked at the Antifa guys? Have you ever really looked close at them, you know, when they were riding?
No, I'm trying not to look too closely, to be honest.
Well,
but what do you notice, Father?
They're all man boys.
What do you mean?
Man boys. They're guys in their 30s who have never accomplished anything, have never really mm-hmm. faced any real problem. And yeah. all of a sudden, you know, the call to arms, right? And, mm-hmm. and you know, there's every man has a hero story.
Right.
Right. But that's intrinsic in us.
Right.
All boys have it. I ask them, what was your hero story? You know, and they'll tell me. Mine was, I'd be walking across a bridge, I see people drowning, I jump in the river, and I'm going to save them. Every boy has that. It's
wow.
something in the manly nature.
Wow.
Right?
Uh-huh.
It is. It's there. Women don't have that. Every boy does, right? Well, here are these guys. They've kind of assimilated. They've kind of assimilated the weakening, the weakness, right? And haven't done anything to change their lives. Smoke dope, you know, until they're 30 years old and underperform and all this and that. And you know, the big cause comes in. They're the first ones on the street, you know, ready to loot the building, right? They're all man boys.
And so they're getting their sense of heroism. Their sense of heroism is being channeled into this destructive area.
And you know, Dostoevsky wrote about that in Demons, right? It was really a strong insight. He said the revolutionaries are always the products of weak fathers.
That's really interesting.
Is that interesting? Yeah.
Yeah. And he would know that he was really dealing with the first, I don't want to call them the first generation of revolutions, but this is a pre-Russian revolutionary. Right?
Exactly.
Right.
And he was witnessing the de-Christianization, the deconstruction of the intelligentsia. Mm. And he could see, you know, he was a contemporary of Nietzsche, you know, they read mm. each other. It was the same time. And completely different results, right? One
right.
is nihilism, yeah. and one is prophetic. It's prophetic.
Yeah.
And he saw where it's going to go. But I thought it was a brilliant psychological insight
mm-hmm.
that the revolutionaries come from weak, indecisive fathers.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that's so interesting. That brings me to another question that I thought of when I first thought of engaging you on these matters, and we haven't gotten back to it. I have a theory that the sexual revolutionaries, now not just feminists, but this whole sexual revolution and the whole radicalization, which includes de-Christianization of society, getting the men out of the family and off the political stage was a huge strategic victory for them.
Yes.
Yeah. And I know why I think that. And you're agreeing with it right away. What do you think about that? In what way was it a big coup for them to do that?
Well, you ruined the next generation. You ruined the next generation. I mean, it started in the Great Society, right? I remember Heather McDonald. I'm sure you read Heather McDonald.
Mm-hmm.
She said that before the Great Society in Harlem, 65% of Black households were in two-parent families,
yep.
and the trend was moving up. 10 yep. years later, it was reversed.
Yep. Yeah, she's right about that.
And so, you know, I mean, what, you know, What happened? Where did common sense go? Anybody who had, you know, an ounce of wisdom could have predicted this. How did this happen?
Well, I don't think that the people of the 1960s were smart enough to figure out everything that they were doing. I sometimes think that the evil one is smart enough to orchestrate all these things in such an exquisite way as he did. But the fact is, if the father's out of the home, the women and children are sitting ducks for predators, number one. Number two, they need other protection. They need other providers. The government becomes the providers. Protection is kind of not really there. And the children of unmarried parents are vulnerable to sexual predation. So it's not simply the politicization of the whole thing, which is bad enough, because we now know that unmarried women vote woke more reliably than just about any constituency, because the government is their husband and so on and so forth, all the reasons a lot of people have adduced. But it's also true that the children, so there's the whole financial and political side of this thing. Mm-hmm. But, you know, predators like Jeffrey Epstein's victims, some of them testified, Father, that his pimps that went around procuring girls for him, they specifically targeted girls from foster care. Okay.
Yep.
So this system also makes young people vulnerable to even sexual predation, you know? And so in a way it's an exquisitely timed, carefully put together piece of destruction to maximize itself and to perpetuate itself. But we who are opposing it need to understand what we're dealing with. Right. And therefore get the fathers back in the family. Therefore, help the women to understand what it means to have a good husband, what to ask for, what to look for, what to reward in the guy, rather than, you know, doing all these kind of crazy self-destructive things that we've been doing.
I want to riff off that a little bit, because I used to think that these were like my acting days, and when I was more of a culture warrior type, you know, that these were, the function of just bad ideas.
Mm-hmm.
All right. But I don't believe that anymore. I'm agree with your implicit notion that it's a diabolical plan. The devil's behind all this. You look at now, I deal with the pornography issue. Boy, I tell you why, and I wrote about this in the editorial, that the first time I really wrote about it publicly was that it comes from the depths of hell.
Mm-hmm.
It comes from hell. Okay. Why? Because if we can destroy the characters of young men when they're just entering manhood, 13, 14, 15 years old, then we can destroy them for a lifetime.
Mm-hmm.
We weaken them. We don't kill them, but we weaken them so they can never become strong men. This is diabolical.
Right.
And an idea like that, not just an idea, but the production of pornography and everything that's involved. It's just not a matter of ideas. It's a matter of evil energy, demonic energy. It really is.
Yeah. And because it's not just the ideas, it's the way the ideas have been brought to life in institutions and laws and social practices and movies and, you know, all of the rest of it. And when you think about the idea that every man is the prince of his own castle, you know, and is there to protect his own family, protect his own. Now you have a whole society full of people who don't have that. Well, that means if you're a person who's interested in seizing power within the society or being the top guy in the society and getting away with stuff, that's a lot better for you. Right. If nobody's got a dad to protect them, you know, that makes your job a lot easier. And, you know, conspiracy theory, I don't know if it's a conspiracy, but, I feel like we certainly have a lot of policies that have stacked up on one corner, you know.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. I wasn't before. I really wasn't. But I began to see that it's one of the reasons why I shifted into this. And also some personal circumstances in my life where I kind of just left off the old way of trying to convince people, right?
Uh-huh.
But actually, you know, it happened. I was praying one day, Lord, what do I do? And basically what I heard was, open your eyes, open your eyes. And I did. And these young men started coming into my life, and I realized these guys are falling off the cliff.
Yeah,
they are falling off the cliff. And that's when this work started. Sometimes I even reached over the cliff and pulled them back up and put them on solid ground.
Yeah.
And that's where the work is. That's where the work is. And that's how we're going to change the world.
Right. Right. Yeah. And that brings me to a good place to end our conversation, because we're coming close to the end of the hour. I can't believe this went by so fast. Listen up, Ruthie's. Was this not a lot of fun, this conversation with me and Father Hubert?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It was really good. I really enjoyed it. It was really good. It's so rich. It's rich.
Yeah. We could go on all day. But anyway, we won't go on all day. I just have one last thing I want to ask you. When you gave that talk at the Touchstone Conference back in whatever it was, 2017 or 18, something like that, you mentioned at the beginning, every other speaker has said, well, what do we do now? And no one knows what to say. Everybody is So it seems like since that time, you've developed at least something that we can do, and you're doing it, right? And so how do you feel 5 years on, you know, how is our doing, you know, and what else should we be doing?
Well, you know, the world hasn't changed from the top down or the bottom up. It's changed from the inside out. It is. And you look at how Christ did it. He had 12 men. They spoke the truth. I love Alexander Solzhenitsyn. One word of truth outweighs the world. We speak and do what is true.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we do. That's because that's all we can do, but that's not what I mean by that phrase. That's all we can do, I know, but that's what needs to be done.
That's right. More than anything.
Okay. And so I just figure, I'm working down here in Southwest Florida, right? And what I see is that the work, it's increasing. Mm-hmm. It's increasing. Like I go here now, I go there now, and there's something about these words that are really true. See, I didn't know the power of this until even going into Touchstone. I did not know how it was going to be received. I had it all planned. I kind of winged it. I didn't know what to say. So I just talked about my experience. But it was the response, not only from some key people who were there that I really respect, hearing what they said, but also that as that video went on a slow viral, I started getting calls, phone calls from other young men. They found me and they called me, and I asked every single one of them. I said, well, what was it about that lecture that really grabbed you? And they all said the same thing. They said, it's what you said about the pornography and the master being misplaced creativity. That's what really rang their bell and compelled them to call me. Mm-hmm. Right. So I realized that really resonates in the hearts of men. And that also showed me at the same time, I was onto something here and it had to be developed.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm just every day I run a church too. So but that keeps my feet on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
Every day I just do my work and it grows, and I hope it's pleasing to God, because I'm doing it for the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And what else can we do? That's right. How it's done. You think the Lord and the disciples.
That's right.
They ended up laying the foundation of an entirely new civilization.
Mm-hmm. And I just want to comment on one of those things. One of the things those men were responding to is when you said that the whole masturbation pornography experience was displaced creative energy. You gave them hope. You gave them some reason to think that there could be some positive change. I think that's I don't know whether you realize that, but embedded within that statement was the possibility of something constructive happening. And they're probably, you know, tired of banging their heads against the wall and feeling despair and all of that kind of thing. So,
well, yes, it's really true. You know, I mean, these things, they kind of clarify as you go along, right? Now I tell guys, you can overcome this.
Right.
Now I'm really bold on that. Mm-hmm. And you can overcome this. I know guys who have overcome this. You can overcome this too. And you can see, like, you could, they start sitting up a little.
Right.
They, you know, there's a future that is kind of coming into view, into focus.
Right.
I'm not a slave to this dissipation.
Right.
Because it does dissipate. And when I say dissipation, it does rob you of your strength, of your focus, of your manliness. Yes, you're absolutely right. Mm-hmm. And they know it. They just can't get past it.
That's right. That's right. And that's what you're helping them to do. So
yeah, that's what I'm helping them to do.
So Father Hans, if people want to get involved with you and what you're doing, if they want to join the brotherhood that you've created, where can we send them? Where can they find you?
Well, they can look at St. Pisces Brotherhood. Are you going to like list us at the bottom of the video and stuff?
It's all going to be at the bottom of the video, folks.
Okay. You
look at the bottom, and he's going to have. But I want you to just describe what they'll find if they go to the St. Pisces Brotherhood.
Okay. Now the Brotherhood is for men only.
Okay.
It's got to be that way.
Sure.
Well, you know, it's got to be that way because men don't talk the same when there are women around.
Oh, no question about it. And we don't either.
Okay. Yeah, that's what I figured. Okay. And then I'm involved in a group called Antiochian Men. That's a diocese-wide thing. It's the same work. It's just diocese work, and the Brotherhood is kind of independent work. Blessed. Mm-hmm. It's blessed, but it's different because that actually started before the bishop asked me to do this in the diocese. So Antiochian Men is another where you can see a lot of my smaller videos, my vignettes. Okay. I'm easy to reach. So people can contact me. My contact, you can get me through Antiochian Men. You can get me through the St. Pisces Brotherhood. I don't do Twitter. I don't do any of that. I just don't have the time for it. And it's too much of a distraction. You know, if I start reading Twitter, I start reading everybody's comments.
Right.
And I just can't do it. I don't have the time for that.
Oh, I don't have the patience for it. And I think we put our souls at risk sometimes. I feel if I'm on Twitter very long, I feel like.
I don't listen to talk radio anymore. Because it stirs up my anger, right?
Right. You don't need that. Yeah.
I don't need that. It's an energy drain.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well. Yeah. Well, so Father Hans, thank you so much for being my guest on today's episode of the Dr. J Show. And to all of you Ruth Institute followers who have watched this video all the way to the end, it's because you really loved this video. And so I would really encourage you to subscribe to this channel and to share this video with your friends and send your friends to the sites that Father Hans has suggested. And I know that they're going to be very blessed by what he's had to say. And Father Hans, we have all been very blessed by you being my guest on today's episode of the Dr. J Show.
Thank you very much. And it's a great pleasure to be here. I've enjoyed it very much myself.
Thanks.